What's going on, Mr. Lee here, and this is the first part of the introductory unit for human geography, and we'll be discussing the basics of geography, various types of map projections, and geospatial data. AP Human Geography is not like any geographic concept you have dealt with in the past. You have two main schools of thought, physical geography and human geography. Under physical geography, you would have mountains, deserts, oceans, rivers, and weather, and this is the geography that students are typically accustomed to and what you learn in your third grade class. Under human geography, you have population, culture, politics, industry, agriculture, and the urban environment, all of which essentially make up the units for this class. The primary focus here will be studying the patterns of human behavior and our effect on the world. The five main themes of human geography are movement, regions, location, interaction, and place. We will be looking closely at migration patterns, the reasoning for the existence of regions, the why of where, how humans interact with one another, and place, which is the emotional ties and connections one has to geographic locations. But before we dive into the details of human geography, let's go ahead and get a brief history of geography as a whole. First, we had Aristotle, who was the first to theorize the spherical shape of the Earth. Then Eratosthenes, who coined the term geography and used longitudes and latitudes. And Ptolemy, who created different map projections and plotted out thousands of longitudes and latitudes. But the most important geographer of all, because he is on the AP exam, is Carl Sauer. It's actually spelled this way, but he is the father of human geography.
I am your father.
He was the first to study the human pattern, the why of where. Why is mankind there? Where did they migrate? And what is the reason for their cultural practices? Let's dive into the types of maps you must know, starting with the reference map. And it's called a reference map because there are landmarks labeled for you so that you can use them as a reference.
Wow.
These reference maps used to be more useful, as back in the good old days, you used to use them to guide you as you dangerously attempted to follow the directions that you printed out on MapQuest and match them with the reference map that you printed. As opposed to reference maps, there are thematic maps, and in this case, they're going to have a dominant theme, starting with the categorical map, which are maps that are assigned different colors to the many different categories. For example, this map's theme is going to be NBA teams, and each team is going to be assigned their own color. Then you have our cartogram, which is going to change the size of the map or country based on the quantity of the number. This number can represent essentially anything, depending on the theme that it has, and in this case, it would be population. Take a look at China and India, the two most populated countries in the world, and look at how large they are on this map. To help you remember, think of a cart that keeps getting bigger and bigger as you fill in more quantities of goods in it. There's also the isoline map, and the theme here will be elevation. If you've ever gone backpacking and utilized a map to navigate through the mountains, you've dealt with these before, where each line is going to represent different level of elevation, and these maps are also common with climate and temperature as well. We also have the proportional symbol map, which is also known as a graduated symbol map, and this is going to utilize a symbol or shape and use its size to determine quantities of whatever theme. You can see on the left-hand side, the size of the circle determines the population size, and on the right, you see that the larger circles represent higher oil consumption. There's also the dot density, which is similar to the graduated symbol, but much more detailed in that it uses many dots to represent the frequency of something. In this map, each dot will always represent the same quantity of whatever good, and it will repeat that dot based on the quantity. The darker the dots or color seem, the higher the frequency. Finally, there's a choropleth map, which uses different shades of one color in order to illustrate the variances of an occurrence. Take this map, for example, of COVID in 2020. The map essentially states that the darker shade of red that you have, the more cases of COVID per capita that you have in that country. In order to help you remember, in this word, you see the letters for the word color, which should assist you in remembering that this map has one color, but varying shades to demonstrate frequency. Have you ever tried to peel an orange and make it flat? Well, congratulations. If you have, you have participated in the art of map making, also known as cartography, and we have the most famous of them all, the Mercator projection. This map is known for its direction and navigational purposes, but it distorts size, especially at the northern and southern poles. If you were to look at a normal globe, notice how at the northern pole, the longitudes meet, whereas the Mercator projection separates them at the poles. There's also the Robinson projection, and the Robinson projection is that friend that always tries to make everybody happy, so in turn, they annoy everyone in the process. It's a good projection because everything's a bit distorted, but it's also a bad projection because everything's a bit distorted. Lastly, there's the Peters projection, and in map projections, it's all about the balance between size and shapes. And in this case, it maintains decent sizing, but in the process of maintaining the size, it ruins the shape of the countries. In geography, geospatial data is at the forefront of all analysis nowadays, and we utilize all kinds of technology to gather and store such data. The first type of geospatial data includes GIS, Geographic Information Systems, where a map will contain various levels of data, such as this image. You actually have access to GIS in your handy dandy phones. As you can see, if you go to Apple Maps, you'll see various layers of data that you have access to, and you can look at public transit, traffic, biking lanes, or even COVID data. There are various means of collecting this data, one in particular called remote sensing, where you are utilizing a remotely controlled machine in order to collect spatial data. Some examples of this include satellite imaging, drone footage, or even airplanes. Other methods geographers use to collect data include field observation, which involves visiting the location in person, media reports to analyze patterns and processes, travel narratives, which is similar to a geographic journal, and personal interviews and photographic analysis. At this point, you might be asking, why do we need to collect so much data?
Why?
And one reason why is because businesses want to make money off of this data, such as real estate prices or companies like Disney who want to understand the demographic of their customers. Take a look at this article, which explains why the government would want to collect data, and it is to get insight so that they can better advise the public during a natural disaster or pandemic. Case in point, COVID. Companies may also analyze data to better understand consumer demand and to ensure that they're being environmentally friendly. Now let's talk about distance decay, which states that interactions are more likely the closer you are and less likely the further you are. Use Taco Bell as an example. You have all these Taco Bells in this region, but you chose this one that is closest to you. And this is because when a particular business is closer to you, you are more likely to have an interaction with it, because you are within their hinterland, which is their sphere of influence. The further you are from this Taco Bell, the less likely you are to visit it. An extremely important concept that comes up with the exam very often is the concept of spatial analysis, the study of patterns and geographic phenomena across space, and it is also known as locational analysis. It is the act of studying a given space, analyzing their patterns, and making assumptions. Let's go to make sense of this. Pretend there's a given area called Navy City, and within Navy City, there are three people, Red, OJ, and Purple. You see how they live very close to one another, and that fact that you notice would be spatial analysis, and in this case, would be known as being clustered. Now, let's pretend Purple got a job somewhere else, and OJ got tired of Red's dog barking and messing up their lawn, so OJ decided to move further west away from Red. Now, if you were to conduct spatial analysis on their living conditions, you would describe it as being dispersed. Within spatial analysis, there's a particular concept called absolute location. This is merely a description of location based on exact coordinates. Think of it this way. Red's location is absolute and there's no disputing exactly where he is. Then there's a concept of relative location, which is the description of location based on another object or in reference to another object. And in this case, it would be west of Red. We would utilize relative location over absolute location when you want to analyze the relationship, context, or dynamic of two things. For example, remember that in this instance, OJ moved further away west because Red Dog kept dropping feces in his lawn. In housing spatial analysis, it might look something like this. You have your dispersed region on the left, clustered in the middle, and linear on the right-hand side. Take the dot density map that we looked at earlier. You'll notice that the population is more dispersed in Montana, linear in Salt Lake City, and clustered in the Northeast region. Another geographic concept you need to understand is environmental determinism, the idea that human behavior is strongly influenced by the environment. For example, take a look at this population density choropleth map that shows a lack of population in the Sahara Desert. And this is directly tied with the area's hot, dry, and uninhabitable climate. However, on the other hand, we have possibilism, which is when humans counteract the limitations of the environment and adjust to meet the demands of the people. A perfect example of this would be the Ski Dubai Resort in UAE, where the people adjusted to the extremely hot climate of the Middle East and created a ski resort in the middle of a desert. It is crucial to understand the importance of scale in human geography, as scale can have a drastic impact on the analysis on a topic. Maps can tell lies is what I tell my students. For example, take this national scale map of COVID cases around the world and focus on the United States. Based on this map, one might assume that the United States might have high COVID numbers because it is significantly darker. However, if we were to zoom in and go to a regional scale, we can see that the Southeast region has the highest rates of COVID. Take Florida, for example, which is much darker than most states. But once again, this map is lying because if we go to a local scale, we can see that even within Florida, different counties will range in terms of their COVID rates. Lastly, we have our types of regions, starting with the formal region, which is going to have a predominant trait throughout the region, and you must be able to prove this region. For example, one can prove the boundaries of the state of Texas as they are laid out by the government, and you can also prove the Rocky Mountain region exists because of the elevation. Then there's also functional regions, which have a node or center that is interconnected by activities or services surrounding said node. The analogy I like to use is a wheel, as it has a center and the spokes of the wheel connect the node to the outside. Oftentimes, these are going to be transportation routes and can be seen with France's auto routes, and the node is going to be Paris. Another example of functional regions would be the metro in Los Angeles, as the node will be downtown LA or Union Station, and the service spreads out like a wheel to the various parts of Los Angeles. Finally, there's the perceptual regions, which are cultural and created by people's feelings and attitudes. Take SoCal, for example. When you think of SoCal, you think of beaches, surfers.
Just like you pull in and you just get spit right out of them. And you just drop in and just smack the lip.
And perhaps straight out of Compton. Straight out of Compton. However, where are the boundaries of SoCal? Is it this map that properly outlines SoCal? Or this map? Or this one? Or the next one? Or this one? This is where people will have conflicting opinions, and thus a perfect example of a perceptual region. All right, that about does it for us today. If you haven't done so already, make sure you visit the Quizlet link down below in the description to brush up on your vocab, and have an amazing day, everyone.